Welcome to our afternoon full online session. We are very glad to host you today. Some words before we start then with the real presentation regarding online session, some tips. So please be aware that you are muted during the webinar. You can always raise some questions via the Q&A button. Please do not use the chat, but the Q&A section. The chat can be used if you have any technical issues. I hope you can hear us clear and loud. And Q&A will be either answered during the presentation or we have anyhow at the end of our online session time left for question and answers. So once again, a hearty welcome. Today, your hosts are Silvia Schaphoff. Silvia, all of you, I'm quite aware, you are aware of her, is our head of engineering. She is responsible for the entire support team as well as for our premium authorized training center. By side, a little side note, she's also NSE8. So she's really our technical brain and competence for very long time, and I'm very glad that she will take the most important part from this presentation. Yeah, so nice to have you at my side, Silvia.
Hello, good morning. Thanks, Victor. Thanks, everybody, for joining our morning session or afternoon session in this case. I'm very glad to be here and I'm very glad to meet you. Unfortunately, not in person, but at least virtual. Yes, I'm very happy to show you some of the new 7.0 feature. I really appreciate, but yes, we have to wait a little bit because Victor has some other topics before. So you already know Victor, I think so. If not, Victor is one of our oldest sales engineers at Ball Engineering. And with old, I do not mean the age, but the longest experienced sales engineer. He is working with Fortinet for a lot of years, I think. At least he started some 2004, something about this. So really in the beginning of Fortinet in Switzerland, you already joined the Fortinet big family. So yes, I'm glad to do this show today with you, Victor.
Thank you very much, Silvia. So I would like to take my time as short as possible, but there are some points and that you have an overview. We have a little agenda prepared. So we try to make the first time as short as possible, maybe it's some minutes more. I will give you an introduction regarding FortiGuard offerings and related to, of course, 7.0, what are the changes. We have some cool product news and of course, at the end, some promos running, not just for employees, stay tuned. And then of course, then we will dive in into the real part where I'm very glad that Silvia will then take over. So let's start directly with FortiGuard offering 7.0. If you look on the software evolution stream over the timetable, as Silvia mentioned, version 2.8 is something I'm already aware of. So the green style, which you can have as a retro, let's say, background, you can switch it on if you like this old retro style. But we are speaking now really about the version 7.0. You maybe are aware of that. Silvia and I, we prepare now really since 2017 or 16 even on a yearly base, this online sessions or even morning sessions where we have really the pleasure to introduce the major release changes. And therefore just this as a reference, you see it is quite a long way, a long journey together with Fortinet. And there are a lot of things Fortinet has also introduced over the past few years. Now, FortiGuard offering 7.0, a lot of people know, of course, the bundle services, but it's worth just to highlight some important points. As you know, if you buy a hardware-only box, especially FortiGate, you have normally 1 year default warranty from the vendor, but you are just legitimately allowed to download firmware updates in the first 90 days. Therefore, we always recommend that you really buy as at least a FortiCare bundle together with a standalone hardware. And this FortiCare has not just the warranty, which is included with advanced replacement next business day replacements. There are also some services included in the FortiCare bundle, especially this internet service, database updates. You see it in the list in the first row and in the bottom line. And of course, the FortiGuard app control services will be also already updated with the FortiCare service. As soon you are interested to have a bundle which covers more, the ATP, the Advanced Threat Protection Bundle, helps, especially if you have internal segmentation firewalling, because this has the IPS services included and the FortiGuard Advanced Malware Protection, AMP, which contains the antivirus, mobile malware, botnet, content disarm, reconstruction services for Adobe and Microsoft, and so on, up to the FortiSandbox cloud service. But the run rate, as you know, is the Unified Threat Protection, where we have additionally to the base mentioned services, also the FortiGuard Web. And this is new, the video filtering service introduced, as you see in the highlighted footnote in the top corner right, available when you're running FortiOS 7.x. The next bundle, which is also available as the UTP with a hardware, if you would like, the ATP has to be both as a separate service to the hardware, but the UTP and enterprise bundles can be combined with a hardware bundle, contains additionally to all the services mentioned till now, the FortiGuard security rating, which is quite cool. So I have a best practice and also some PCI compliance ratings, which are presented to you and your customer management. You have the industrial service and IoT detection service. And if you are migrating from an older version of a box of a new hardware version, you can also use the one-time FortiConverter service included in the enterprise bundle. And of course, the 360 protection contains all of the possible services, including manager, analyzer, and SOC as a service in the cloud, which is also a new offering bundled with the 360 protection in 7.0. What is also worth mentioning is that with 360, you have this ASE, the Advanced Service Ticket Handling, which has a dedicated support team with a higher SLA. So double up the speed. And also you can directly as end customer and US partner escalate tickets on a level two tech engineer level. Don't have to start with the level one turnaround. We have also all these services available as a la carte. So if you would like to mix and match, do not hesitate and ask for an offering from us. We can also make co-terms with right-sized services and also pro rata temporis to a request. The other thing is, in fact, as we have seen this base services in another list as a reference for you, all this will be handed out by PDF. We will send you an email as well. This will be recorded. So you can have also then a YouTube link where you can finally also maybe have a look for some details you would like to repeat or share with some of your colleagues internally. In 7.0, as you see, IoT Mac database is a part of the FortiCare bundle already, as well as the Dynamic DNS, which is in IPv6 support included with version 7. The video filtering I mentioned before is part of the web filter, is a higher UTP bundle portion. And of course, the Analyzer Cloud and SOC as a service. I will generally also give you some background changes in the manager and analyzer area. Let's go over to the product news. There has been at the beginning of the year some, let's say, uncertainties. What does it mean? Fortinet has the FortiAnalyzer VMbase as well as FortiManager VMbase in the so-called, pre-announcement that it will be discontinued end of order per April 8th. and they removed it in the mid-coup price list as of May the 3rd. What is very important, this doesn't mean that the perpetual license version is not anymore available. So what you are speaking about is that just the FortiAnalyze and FortiMeter VM base SSQ has been removed, but we have still the add-on SKUs which we can offer as we are used to. As well, the subscription VM SKUs are not affected, and there are no plans that Fortinet would replace the permanent models with subscription model. So this is really something is an add-on. So your customer and you have still the freedom to choose the way you like, which is most suitable for you. What is the change is that the base licenses have been replaced by a free trial license. And this is not an EVA license, which is terminated after 60 days. This is a really a free trial license, which is a permanent license. So for your current customers will, in fact, nothing change. So if they would like to add additional device or logging capacities on the managed analyzer, you can still order the add-ons. Or, of course, with the subscription, this is something you can stack. So neither the VM subscription license nor the permanent VM license is affected by this change. If you would like to have existing customers as well for new customers, what you have to be aware, the process, it's not something you buy. The e-trial license can be directly generated in the FortiCare account. And this is the process which we indicate also in our offers. And yeah, you will also get some additional references on the Fortinet docs site. So this is for you as a reference. I don't go to each individual test, but I invite you try it out and have your own look. Currently, one side remark is this is just for the moment available on the major FortiCare account. But the plans are that you could have this also multiplied. So it's currently just one time free trial license, but as Fortinet indicated, there should be a possibility to download it or make it available for your employees as well internally as a reseller. Please check out the referenced FortiAnalyzer Manager trial license guides on the Fortinet document library. In mind, the trial free trial license containing three devices, FAUDOMS, and 1 gig logs per day in the FortiAnalyzer flavor, two ADOMs in max, and the FortiManager three devices, VDOMs, and two ADOMs as well. And there is no support included in the free trial. So if you would like to have a supported version, you have to purchase add-on license. The smallest amount is 1 gig per day on the analyzer. And in the FortiManager flavor, it's a 10 device FAUDOM add-on and the corresponding range of FortiCare. And in this situation, you have then also the support as expected. A side note, the FortiAnalyzer Cloud and FortiManager Cloud, which is also available as a part of the 360 protection bundle requires an premium account license. So please be aware, even you buy a 360 or the portion as a la carte service per device, you need on the account this premium account license, which is referenced under note one. And if you use a 360 bundle, you have to be aware that the FortiAnalyzer Cloud depends on the size of the model you are using. You get 1 gig per day. If you have a desktop model, so a two-digit or a VM model with two CPUs, you have 5 gigs per day for a 1U model. With VM models, it's a 4C equivalent and 10 gigs per day if you have a 2U model and something which have at least 8 CPUs.
Many thanks, Victor. We already have a question regarding the FortiManager. Maybe we can answer it right now. The question is, will FortiManager be available only in the cloud? I think no.
So FortiManager is in fact something which will always, not just in the cloud, but also on-prem, but you have the freedom to choose. So as I mentioned, the version I have just now on that slide, this is the SaaS service where the 40 analyzer, the 40 manager is hosted by Fortinet. The other two, which I referenced before on the other slides, these are the VM and the subscription licensing, where you have your license either used on-prem on your hypervisor infrastructure, or you use the same, bring your own licenses in a Azure or an AWS or Google Cloud. So you have the freedom to choose. I hope this answered the question. Huh?
Perfect, great answer, thank you.
So another thing which I have to, just to be maybe a little bit highlighted, that there are these so-called administrative domains in the hardware models, which has a default value, which quite often is as well the maximum number which is supported depending on the model range. And the nice exception is the 3000G series, where we have 500 as a default number. And you can buy additional ADOM subscription licenses to expand it up to 1200. But this is something which is really just available for this 3000G series. The same is regarding virtual machines. You have to be aware the supported default numbers of ADOMs depends on the licensing size. Is not stackable. So if you would like to have this amount of logging volume and storage related to this 1, 5 and 25 gigs per day and so on, licensing scheme, you still can buy separately this ADOM subscription license if the number of ADOM is not sufficient. So just head out and ask for an offer at our site. So this is in fact the points to Fortinet's 40 manager. Some of you have maybe also followed our morning session regarding wireless, what's new in the wireless specs. And this is a reference. You see, we started with the 40AP suffix C, EF, and in the future, we will maybe see also the G series. So what we can say for sure, C is end of order, getting close to end of support date. We have quite a lot of E series out. This is then 802.11 AC Wave 2. But there is also an announcement that they have been put on an end of order state. And what we are now really using as the current run rate is the F series, which is Wi-Fi 6, 802.11 AX. Maybe you have heard about the Wi-Fi 6E standard, which will be regulatory domain related 6 gigahertz window. This will just be available as soon as ETSI gets the okay in our European countries. And I'm quite sure that Bacom, Comcom will follow then the ETSI regulations. Currently, the United States will maybe start earlier, but products are currently anyhow not available. And this is then the change, it's Wi-Fi 6E, which will support then 6 gigahertz band as well. But we recommend also from client side to start and use the F series as they are here right now and available. As a reference for you, what are the changes? Wi-Fi 6, it's a high efficiency wireless use, but it's no magic, it's still a shared medium. But of course we have some additional new technologies. So this is nothing special, no magic behind it, as all other vendors are related to the Wi-Fi 6. We will see that in the future that also the clients have to follow, of course, the feature sets regarding to use the full spectrum. These are the products Fortinet has already in the portfolio. And they are, as of May 21, already 8 access points certified. And these are the F series, which are supporting 11AX. So indoor, outdoor, in different flavors with internal, external antennas. Ask for an offer if you have concrete projects. 40 APOS platform availabilities. We have to differentiate. Each FortiGate can be a wireless controller. So 40OS 7X, we are speaking about just in a short time. On the FortiGates will and do support, of course, all old legacy models and versions. So it's backward compatible. But as you would like to install 7.0 on the Forti access point as operating systems, only the F-series and this referenced E-series will be capable to install Forti APOS 7.0, but still then only the F-series is Wi-Fi 6. The E-series remain the well-known Wave 2 versions. Okay. If you have any question, just reach out and ask. Huh? Okay, so in a nutshell, that's the most important things to remember from the product news and regarding our promos. Because these E-series have been phased out, they have been removed from the Q2 price list and they are going to be end of order. This is in fact the snapshot of what is the recommended replacement where you have the possibility to even to use then trade up as the way to go where you have better conditions. And some words, what does it mean to use trade up? If a product is set into this end of order stage, Fortinet gives a favor that if you have still services running on the hardware models, which are end of order, which are not expired more than 12 months at least, we can quote and trade up. You find on the partner portal more details, of course. Important is that as soon you profit from a trade up quoted offer, this product, which has been used for trade up, will no longer qualify for further trade ups and also is not qualified for renewals. And if you have to fulfill and trade up shipment, we have to order it at Fortinet in Taiwan. So it's approximately 40 days delivery time. There is a quite an important point if you have not just access point, but maybe also some end of order FortiGates, you could also make a so-called transfer of service. So you can really move some support subscriptions. But this is only legally supported if you are in this trade-up matrix on the horizontal line. So there are no possibilities to jump out of the scope. But of course, if you don't have a long-term period of services running on the end of order product, it's mostly something you can forget. But if there is enough time which you would like to cover and it's in the recommended replacement, please ask for a corresponding hardware only offering, especially in the FortiGates, not a bundled one, because with this so-called asset management ERMA process used for moving the service, this replaces any bundles which are glued to the target system. So if you take a box with 5 years UTP and you make a transfer of service, you will erase the 5 years. So this is not a good idea. So therefore, please check this as a reference and otherwise ask for support from our side. So sorry for some German wording in between. I just do not translate it everything, just testing. But as you have seen quite sure in our last newsletters regarding the price list updates, we have still a campaign running where we make a competitive trade-in. And this is valid still end of this month. So if you have any project, please, the order have to be placed at Boll at the 30th of June till early afternoon so that we can still process it against Fortinet. So this is just as a reminder, and you find this information as well on our manufacturer info site and in our newsletter. And last but not least, as something I would like just to highlight, we are planning a Fortinet summer special together with Fortinet, where you will have the possibility as partner, especially as employee of a Fortinet reseller in Switzerland, Liechtenstein, with a valid NSE 1, 2, or 4 and higher certification to get for a private use to a very attractive price, a FortiGate, an AP or a switch, as well some service renewals. So watch out, we will send out in a short time a separate newsletter before end of this month. And then we are looking forward to help you to get latest and greatest hardware as well, support contracts that you can test. That what I'm heading over to Sylvia, promising 7.0 gives us the possibility to play with. So these are the updates from my sales side, and I love to give the word now to Sylvia.
Okay, thanks, Victor. Many thanks for the introduction here and some really nice news and information. Yeah, so now we are going a little bit more deep dive. Now I'm going to start some presentation of the new 7.0 features. But before we are doing so, I just want to show you some general, I think, very necessary information. So let's share my screen just a second. Yes, okay. So right now you should see a blue slide with some general information. So before I'm going to start with my live demo, I just want to give you some more information. So what's necessary when we talk about FortiOS 7.0, when we talk about upgrading and so on. So the most important thing I think is, which models are still supported with 7.0. And for this, I have pretty good news, because all the models that already supported 6.4 are supporting 7.0 too. So we are losing no models from 6.4 to the newest major release to 7.0. So every model that is able to run 6.4 is able to run 7.0 as well. As we see here, it's only the 30 and 50E, which has already phased out with 6.4. So you cannot update to 6.4 and, of course, not to 7.0. All the others are still supporting 7.0. There are just some small exceptions. As you can see here, for example, the 80F or the 200F, they are not supported right now with 7.0.0. So this does not mean that we won't support 7.0 on those pretty new models. This means that this is not supported with the zero patch release. So I think with the next release, patch 1, we will have support for the 80F, and I hope so with the 200F and the other devices which are not supported with the zero patch, with the general availability patch, but all the new models will be supported later on. We just have to wait for the first or second patch. As far as I know, the first patch, 7.0.1, should be released this week on Friday. This is not guaranteed, but I think so. I hope so. Okay. So regarding the models, everything is fine. Everything that is supporting 6.4 is supported with 7.0 as well. So, what does it mean? Do you have to update to 7.0? Let's say no, not yet. This is my personal opinion, and I will explain why. So first of all, this is a general availability release. As with every general availability release, we will get a lot of new features. I will show you later on. We will have more than 300 new features in this 7.0 release. And of course, new features always means there's a possibility for some obstacles, for some, let's say, room for improvement. You know what I mean. So it's pretty likely that you might have some obstacles if you're already updating, if you have already updated to 7.0. So my personally opinion, especially with my experiences from, yes, my job role as a support engineer, maybe you want to wait a little bit for the first, second, third, or maybe the fourth patch. So why do you have to wait so long? Because Fortinet is implementing new features not only in the general availability release, but also in the first, in the second, and sometimes also in the third patch. So maybe you wait for the second patch, there might be new features in the second patch. So this is why I say, okay, if it's not really necessary, if you do not really need some of the new features, then maybe you want to wait. If you need some new features really right now, of course, then you do not have a choice. But as I said, you do not have to upgrade right now or tomorrow or next week, maybe a little bit later. You can run with 6.2 and 6.4, but also you do not want to get stuck with the very old releases. As you can see, the 5.4 or 5.6 release, at least the 5.4, the very first one here in my table, this is already in end of support for more than 1 year. 5.6 is in already in end of engineering support and will get in the end of support in September this year. So maybe you are laughing, but I remember last month I had a support call with a device running 5.4. So yeah, some devices are still running with this old, pretty stable, it seems so, pretty stable releases. But yes, you shouldn't do so because some security issues are there, not that strong encryption algorithms or SSL versions. So maybe you want to update. 6.0 is getting into the end of engineering support next week. What does it mean? End of engineering support means that Fortinet is not updating this version anymore, other than really critical security issues. So if they notice some critical security issues, they will update 6.0 with another patch, maybe patch 13 or 14, but all the other stuff which they might get to their intention, which is not a security issue, isn't being updated anymore in this major release. So maybe you want to run with 6.2, or I personally would prefer 6.6 right now. That's fine. And if you're really curious, maybe you want to run 7.0, but maybe not on a productive firewall. Just use the firewall at home or in your test lab or wherever. Okay, so if you decide to upgrade, no matter why you're doing so, you can directly upgrade from 6.4.4 or 6.4.5 or 6.4.6. These are the three releases where a direct upgrade to 7.0 is supported. If you're not running one of those patches, if you're running, for example, an earlier release, let's say 6.0.12, then you need to follow the supported upgrade path, which is in this case updating to 6.2.9, the latest patch release of 6.2, then 6.4.6, the latest patch release of 6.4, and then you can upgrade to 7.0. So if you're not sure about the supported upgrade path, that's not a problem. You have a great link on your support portal from Fortinet. So log into your support account at support.fortinet.com, go to download, then click on firmware images, and then use the tab upgrade path, as you can see in the screenshot here. Then you can choose your device, the current version of the FortiOS, and then the version you want to upgrade to, and then you will get automatically the recommended supported upgrade path. Okay, so these are just some basic information for upgrading 7.0. So, but let's get to the point. Let's go to some highlights. What is new? As I already told before, we have more than 300 new features. And yes, 7.0 has been released 3 months ago. This is a pretty long time already. And we, our morning session, normally we are doing this morning session much earlier, so directly after the release of this version. This time we waited a little bit longer on purpose. So this time I wanted to wait that long before we are doing this session because I wanted to wait for the very first patch, 7.0.1. Why is this? Last year, when I did the morning session for 6.4, everything was great. There were some great features we presented. But then 6.4.1 has been released, and there have been additional great features, and nobody has been aware of this. So nobody gives some information about the new features we had in 6.4.1. So, for example, a very, very important feature has been the zone concept concept for the SD-WAN. So this has changed from 6.4 to 6.4.1, but nobody has noticed this. Nobody was aware of this. And so I said, okay, this time I wanted to be a little bit better. I wanted to do the show on 7.0.1 to get the greatest highlights from everything. Yeah, unfortunately, I thought 3 months would be enough. So we scheduled this date. Unfortunately, 7.0.1 hasn't been released. So it's scheduled on Friday, as I have heard. I hope so, but unfortunately, I cannot give you any information about this new patch. So we have to stay with the feature from 7.0.0. Yeah, unfortunately, there already had been a lot of other What's new sessions from Fortinet, from other guys. So there already had been a lot of sessions with all the new features. So yeah, what should I do now? Should I give you all the same information again? So yeah, I'm wondering last week, what could I say? What something that's new? And then I decided I do something different today. Today I do not want to show you the big new highlights, the big new features like zero trust network access, like the FortiGuard video filtering, like the new features from the security fabric. Even though that are great features, I'm pretty sure you have already heard about it. So just not to tell you everything again, that you will hear the story twice or a third time, I decided to take care about the small features, the small one which might be absolutely helpful for every administrator for his daily job. So maybe with this I can show some small features which may be really helpful for you as well. And I think there are some pretty important feature which I want you to know. So yeah, I will stop talking a little bit. No, I do not stop, but I wanted to start with my live demo. So I will end my presentation, my slides here, and will show you some live web UI and give you some information about what I want to show you. So let me stop this one here. Okay, so perfect. So now we should have you should see my browser, perfect, with two firewalls. I have two firewalls for showing you some new stuff. Let's start with this one. I will log in. Okay. So, yeah, where should I start? So I think, yeah, I will start with the menu. I will go down with these points here. And the first thing, which is pretty new in 7.0, is some reordering of this main menu here in the left. So maybe you are aware of the system and security menus. They have been in the top in the previous version, and now they have been reordered to the very bottom, because maybe you're not using this so often. So get the more important things like the dashboard, like network, like policies, more in the beginning, and the stuff this which you are not configuring that often more to the end. So this is the first change in 7.0, and there's another one. For example, the SD-WAN. Yes, SD-WAN still there, but maybe you remember there have been three different SD-WAN topics here in the main menu in the previous releases. Now these three topics or these three menus have been placed to a new submenu. So you will see the submenu here instead of having the topics here in the main menu. And the same has been done for the traffic shaping. Traffic shaping here is only one menu, but you will have a new submenu here. If you go to traffic shaping, you will see the traffic shapers, the traffic shaping policies, and some traffic shaping profiles if you are using them. So the menu has changed, but just a little bit. Okay. So when we are talking about those general stuff, maybe you have noticed something when I did my log on. Did you see this sign in with FortiCloud? This is a new feature with 7.02. So yeah, we already know about this single sign-on feature we had before with the SAML implementation. So you have been able to log in with the SAML account. But this here, sign-in with FortiCloud, is something different. This is something, is another configuration. So, and what is this? So let's show you what we can do here. If I go to sign-in with FortiCloud, I will get a new login prompt. I click here to sign in as the Identity Access Management. This is a new feature from Fortinet as well, which works with my FortiCloud single sign-on. It's still in beta. I will show you more information later on. I just want to give you an example how it looks like. So now I can log in with another account, and this is an account which is managed in my support account. So let's type in my password like this, and now I can do a log on to my firewall, to the local firewall, with a single sign on with a user which is managed not on the local firewall but on my Fortinet support portal. So just to give you a proof, if I go to system administrators, there's no Sylvia here. It's this one, but this one is a FortiCloud SSO admin, you will see here. So, and how do you manage those single sign-on user? Therefore, let me show you another browser. So I will show you something you may be aware of. This is the support portal from Fortinet, and I logged in, and which is pretty important for this, you need to log in with the end user account, not with your partner account. Log in with the end user account, and right now you have to use the master user of this account. Once you have logged in with this one and you click on services, you will see a new menu, which is the Identity Access Management, which is still in beta, as I said before. So what can you do here? Here you can, try it again. Yeah, now it looks better. Okay, just give it a second. Oops, hello, something is stuck. This is the problem of some live demos. Shit, I'm sorry. Let me. I'm sorry. It seems that I'm getting locked out right now, or I do not have any internet connection anymore. That's strange. Okay, here we are again. Okay, here we are back. Ooh, hopefully everything works well in the next hour with my internet connection. Okay. So we are at the Identity Access Management from the FortiCloud, which you can reach through your support portal. Still remember, go in with the end user account and with the master user. Here you can manage a totally new user database. So you can create a new user, no matter if he is member of your partner account or if it's still a completely different user. You just have to create a new user. On purpose use especially another email address, but it could have been another email address, not from Boll, from any other, so it doesn't matter. And now I can give this user specific permissions. So I will edit this to show you a little bit better. So what can we do here? So I can give him different permissions, for example, permissions for doing single sign-on on FortiGates. So here, if I edit this, I can give him admin or read-only access rights. Okay, but it's not only for the single sign-on. I can give admissions for doing asset management, registering new devices in my support portal, or having getting some information about this one, reading, do admin, he can get admin rights, read-only or read-write admissions, or he can manage the user in the Identity Access Management, or he can do other stuff in the FortiCare to get read-only or read-write access, to create some technical tickets or to open a new customer service ticket, to ask for an RMA and so on. And this can be managed centrally here. So if we are talking about the single sign-on, for example, or for support cases, then it's not only the permissions to open a support case or to log into a FortiGate. You can additionally say to which FortiGate this permission belongs to. So you can give permissions to all of your devices or only to a specific group of the devices. And this one is in this case defined here in a group. You can create user groups and so on. But what's important, you can define those permissions based on the asset management groups you're creating. So let's say here I have a list of all of our devices we have registered with Boll Engineering. But if I go to this folder, I can create different subfolders and move some of the devices into those folders. And now I can give specific access rights only for this specific group. So you can have different users with different access rights to different FortiGates in your account. And this can be managed completely centrally here in this support portal. You do not have to do this on the FortiGate itself. You can do this centrally. And you can change it whenever you want to do this. The only thing you have to configure on your FortiGate is to allow this single sign-on. And this has been done. This will be done in the settings. So if you go to the system settings, you have a new 7.0 feature, FortiCloud single sign-on. If you enable this one and you have a FortiCloud user, which we have configured before, then this one, like Sylvia, is able to log into this firewall. Of course, as a local administrator, you can disable this if you do not want to have an external user to log in this one. But right now I'm not allowed to because then I'm still logged in as Sylvia. So let me log out and log in with a local user. Then I'm able to disable this feature. Okay. So almost. Okay. So go back to system settings. And now I would be able to disable this one and then I'm not allowed. Okay, let's log out. Then, of course, you do not see this FortiCloud login anymore. Okay, so I think this is a nice feature because you can, let's say you have some devices managed and then you can give your customers access to their firewalls by this feature or another support engineer who might be able to log in only for a short time. And you can centrally manage all this stuff from your support account. You do not need access to the firewall itself. So I think this is a very nice feature. But of course, just to be mentioned it again, it's a beta feature right now. So yeah, maybe keep this in mind. And of course, yes, maybe we need some more feature here. For example, as you might have seen, if I give access to the single sign-on to the FortiGates, I'm only able to give admin or read-only access rights. So if I disable this one, go back again. Here I'm only to give access rights as an administrator or read-only administrator. And of course, maybe we need some more additional permissions here later on. I'm pretty sure that this will come in a later version of this identity access management. Okay. And of course, just keep in mind, this is a cloud service. So if for some reason the Fortinet server are not responsive or something like this, you cannot log in with a single sign-on as well. So keep this in mind that this is not, that you need this access to the identity access management to log in with such a SSO user. Okay, so this is one of the new feature I really like, and I think we at least at Boll Engineering, we will use this feature later on and hopefully this is helpful for you as well. So what else? So we have configured this one here in the system settings. And as we are already here, I just want to show you one really funny thing. Victor has already mentioned it. Again, with the new version, we have new colored themes for our web UI. And one I really like a lot because I'm remembering the good old times. And I'm not sure if anybody of you still knows this coloring, because this is the coloring we have used in the very, very beginning of Fortinet when we worked with FortiOS 2 dot something and 3 dot something. We had this really funny green, and we are with this color theme. I still remember those good old time. But of course, we do not have this old coloring. We have also the dark coloring. So dark mode is really a hype right now. So you can do this with the FortiGate as well, using the dark mode. Or I personally prefer the blue one. So yeah, choose the color you really like. Okay, this is just not very important, but worth to mention, I think. At least I had a lot of fun with this one. So now get to the very important things. I wanted to show you next a feature I really love, network interfaces. We have an interface migration wizard coming with 7.0. And this wizard can do two things. One thing, you can change the VLAN ID of an existing VLAN interface. I'm not sure if you're aware of those who already needed this feature. I'm pretty sure that they are aware of, but when you create a VLAN interface, you were not able to change the ID later on. If you really needed to change this ID, what you needed to do was to delete all the objects configured to this interface, then delete the interface, create a new one with the right ID, and then reconfigure all the objects you have deleted before, like firewall policies, address objects bound to this interface, and so on and so on. So this was really nasty. Of course, there had been some workaround by doing a backup, editing the backup configuration file, and then restore it, and the firewall needs to reboot and so on. But right now we can do it on the fly. We just can do, okay, change it to 10. And the nice stuff is that everything which needs to be changed because of this change will be done automatically through this wizard. So right now there's only one interface address bound to this interface. There are no changes in this one. So this one is a pretty easy one. Okay. Done. We are ready. Everything was successful. Now it has the VLAN ID 10. Pretty easy. This is one of the features from the new interface migration wizard. And the other possibility of this interface migration wizard is that you are able to migrate a physical interface into another interface, for example, SD-WAN zone, a normal zone, aggregated interface. So you can migrate an existing interface to another virtual interface. And this is pretty easy. So just click on it, click on the integrate interface. Then you will be asked, oh, okay, what do you want to do? Do you want to migrate this to another interface, like an aggregate or redundant interface or software switch? Do you want to migrate this interface to a zone or to a SD-WAN? So I can do this like, yeah, to migrate it to a zone. Then I'm going to be asked, okay, is it a new zone or do you want to create a new zone? Let's say it's an existing zone like this one. I want to migrate this into this zone. Then I click on next. And now he's asking, okay, hey girl, there are two objects bound to this interface that you want to migrate. What should we do with this? Should we delete it or do you want to replace the instance? So should we move it into the zone? So for example, there's an address object bound to this interface I want to migrate, bound to internal 7. So keep in mind, it's an internal 7 address, 10.7.7.7, bound to internal 7. Once I migrated everything, this will be updated automatically to the new zone. So now this address, oh, okay, I need to refresh my screen. So let's have a look at it directly. Go to the firewall addresses. It's here. Now it's bound not to internal 7 anymore, but to the new zone. So everything is done automatically. Deleted the old information and updated to the new ones. And I think this might be really helpful, especially, for example, if you want to move an interface into an existing SD-WAN, even though there are a lot of configuration on this interface, this might be really helpful. Okay, great feature, but to be honest, unfortunately, it's not working without any issues right now. It's a 7.0.0 release and there are some issues. So to be honest, once there's a firewall policy configured on this interface, the migration will fail. Now, I think that will be fixed in one of the next patches, but right now it's not working for really complex configurations. Only if they are easy objects like an address object or something like this, but firewall policies, for example, are not working right now. But as I said, I think this will be fixed later on. Okay, just to be honest with you. Okay, but once this is working, this feature will be great. I really love it. Okay, so this is the interface migration feature. So now we are in the networking part. Let's give you some more information about the networking part. Some new features here is that that the FortiGate itself is supporting DNS, and additionally, it's now supporting DNS over HTTPS and DNS over TLS. Some people called it DOT and DOH or DOT. As a short form, this means DNS over TLS or HTTPS. We are supporting all the three versions right now, which means the firewall is able to answer on a DNS over TLS request, and additionally is able to request a DNS address with DNS over HTTPS or TLS and so on. If you enable all three of this, the firewall will start with DOT. So these are my DNS servers from the firewall. If the firewall want to do a DNS resolution, it's asking the primary or secondary DNS server on DNS over TLS. If there's no response, it tries DNS over HTTPS. And if there's no response, then it will try DNS plain on UDP without encryption. So all of this is supported, and not only the traffic from or to the FortiGate directly, the firewall is also able to decrypt such DNS request if you're configuring this in your SSL SSH decryption profiles. Okay, this is something which I think is really helpful or nice to have. And last but not least, in the network area, I wanted to show you this local out routing feature. So by default, you won't see this menu. It's not there. What you have to do is go to the feature visibility, and where is it here? You have to enable it. Normally it's disabled, but you can enable this. And once it's enabled, you will have this menu here. So what is this local out routing feature? So to be honest, it's not a new feature. We had this before, but this is something you had to configure in the CLI before, only in the CLI. You couldn't configure it in the web UI. And this local out routing means that right now you can configure in the web UI which IP addresses and which interfaces are used by the FortiGate if the FortiGate is doing a request to somebody else. For example, if the firewall is doing a request to an LDAP server or a radio server or an external resources like a list of IP addresses which can be used as an external list, or is doing a DNS request, or is contacting the FortiGuard server. So all the times the firewall is doing an outgoing request, you could configure the source IP if it's not the normal IP of the outgoing interface. So normally what the firewall is doing, let's make this example with an LDAP. If the firewall is doing an LDAP request, it's going to the routing table, okay, which interface, which outgoing interface should be used, okay, and then the source IP of the LDAP request will be the IP of this outgoing interface. This is fine, this is totally okay, but there are some situations where this is not working. So let's have an example. We have an LDAP server which is located on a network which I can reach through an IPsec tunnel. You already know where the problem is. So the firewall is going to the routing table, sees there's a static route to this branch office network or to this remote network where the LDAP server is located, and I'm using the outgoing interface, the IPsec interface, the VPN interface, the virtual interface for the VPN the firewall had created. So normally, by default, this interface does not have an IP address. but we need an IP address for doing this LDAP connection. So the firewall is taking an IP address of one of the other interfaces. So typically, this is not the right one. Typically, the VPN is only available for the internal network, which is communicating to the remote network. And if the firewall is using another IP address, let's say the IP address from the DMZ interface, this is not working. So there we had a problem. So what we have had to do in the earlier versions is to go to the CLI of the LDAP server and configure the appropriate source IP. Huh, and now we can do this on the web UI. And not only on the web UI, this is, can be done centrally on one web. It's not only for the LDAP. You can do everything here on the, on this side. So let's say go into this. Now you can, I will show you something else. I will explain later on why I'm doing so. Now, again, something else, I'm sorry. So let's take this one. So here you can say, okay, if the spam house server is connected by the firewall, then please use an SD-WAN or please use this interface, whatever you want. And then you can configure a manual IP address or you can use the interface IP address. So this is how you override the routing and the source IP address. So to be honest with you, by default, you cannot configure, use the outgoing interface auto and then configure manually an IP address. So let's make this example. Go to auto and here you see manual is grayed out. I'm not sure why this is. Maybe it's room for improvement. Maybe this needs to be fixed, but I could do this in the CLI. With the CLI, I can configure this auto interface as an outgoing interface and manual an IP address. And what I did here is just use the VPN interface for connecting the LDAP server, but use an IP address of an internal network. And with this, the LDAP server can be reached by the firewall automatically because the firewall is using an internal IP address of the internal network, but the request is routed through the VPN interface, which is the good interface for this one. Okay, so this is something nice that you can configure this in the web UI now, and it's nice that you can do this on a central point. So you can configure this centrally at this local out routing web menu. Okay, something I really like because, yeah, from a supporting perspective, we had a lot of support calls because of configuring the right source addresses for especially those VPN connections. Okay. That are some of the new features from the networking area. So let's move on. Let's go to the objects and policies. Okay. So, you see something that is not worth. Okay. I will show you this one on the other firewall because here we have some more traffic and you will get more information. Okay. Let's go to this firewall running 7.0 as well. So what is new? It's not that you can see the bytes, hit counts, and packets which runs through one firewall, but if you do this mouse over event, you will also see some traffic statistics about the last 7 days. You see this? You will see the bytes which are transferred via this firewall rule in the last 7 days. And if you go to the hit count, you will have the same statistics here in the hit count. So this is something interesting, maybe, if it's used, if this firewall is used or not for the last 7 days. And if you go into this firewall, into the details of the firewall, you have this information as well here on this side. You can switch to bytes, packets, or hit count, so you can see, we'll see exactly the same information. You can go ahead and clear the counters with this new button. And what's also new here is the API preview. If you are running with some API, you will get the API preview. You will get the syntax of this API request here automatically. And something which I really love, which is really important, especially for me, hopefully for you as well, is this edit in CLI. So if you click on this, you will jump into the CLI right into this policy. Ah, stop. Now you normally you could interrupt me if I could hear you and say, but this has been possible in the earlier versions as well. And you are right. Jump into the CLI into a specific policy has been possible in earlier version as well. But this edit in CLI button is not only visible for the policies anymore. So let's make an example. Go to SSL VPN, to the settings. Ta-da! We will have the edit in CLI as well. So you can just click on it and you are in the config at VPN SSL settings and you will see everything which is configured via the CLI or how it is configured in the CLI. And this is something really, really nice because sometimes, especially here in the SSL settings, there are some CLI settings like checking the operation system, like having some peer certificate authentications, having some interfaces in this authentication rule, which you are not able to see in the web UI. But by just clicking on the edit in CLI, you will see everything which is configured on this object in the CLI. And that's something which really helps, will shorten my support calls because I will find the answer much earlier. I think this is a nice one. And we will get this in more and more objects, this button, so you can jump into the CLI directly into this object. This is, I think, really helpful. Okay. Then something else I just want to mention, it's I do not want to say it's a new feature. Unfortunately, it's a new bug, but I just wanted to show you what I mean. Okay, so let's make an example. Like let's make another example. I have another good one for this one. Okay, maybe you want to create a new IPsec tunnel and you're using the IPsec wizard for it. This wizard is great because it's doing everything, configuring the phase one, phase two, doing all the routing with the black hole routes and configuring the firewall rules. As example, here is a firewall rule which has been configured automatically via the VPN wizard. This is nice. But typically, at least in my opinion, I, for example, do not like this address object, the naming of the address objects. Or for example, I want to change this service from all to another service. Let's say I want to change it to GCP. Okay, changed it. Now I want to save it. Nothing is happening. Nothing is happening. What's going on? Why is there nothing happening? Why can't, it's a good configuration. Why can I? Why I'm not able to change this. If you scroll down, you will see the reason for it. In the comments, there's an invalid character. These brackets here are not allowed in the comments. But that's funny, huh? Isn't it? Because the wizard from FortiGate has created those brackets, and now I'm not allowed to save it. And it's the same if you want to clone a policy. If you are cloning, copying a policy, there will be an automatic comment with those brackets, and you cannot change this. So what you have to do, just to give you this information, just delete those invalid characters, and then you are able to change it. Now everything is good again. So this is a funny one. I just wanted to tell you to give this information because it took me a few minutes to get the reason for this problem. I said, why am I not able to change it? Because yeah, I didn't see this in the end with the brackets. So just to give you the information that not the same situation will happen to you. That's the only reason I wanted to tell you this one. But maybe or hopefully in 7.0.1 this will be fixed. We will see. Okay, so just for your information. Okay, so we have talked about the IPsec. So let's jump to the IPsec. IPsec. There's one little feature I really like. Go to the IPsec, use the right mouse click, and now we have this show matching log. This is something you already knew from earlier, from previous releases, but only from the firewall rules. In the firewall, you can do this right mouse click, show matching logs, and you will see all the traffic logs matching to this firewall policy. And now we can do the same with the IPsec tunnels. So if I go to this show matching log, I will jump to the event logs, to the VPN events, and there's already a filter for this IPsec. And this is pretty nice because, yeah, once I've created, for example, I've created a new IPsec tunnel, and it's not establishing the negotiation fails, then I can just jump into this log just by a right mouse click, and then I will see the error messages here. In my case, everything is working, so I do not see any error messages. But in the case something is not working, you will all you will see instantaneously what is happening with this tunnel from this logs. So this is something nice as well. Okay, and when we talk about IPsec, next thing I wanted to talk is the SSL VPN, because here we have another nice feature. With the SSL VPN, we are now able to create not only mobile user or dial-up SSL VPNs, we can configure a branch office VPN from one FortiGate to the other FortiGate with SSL VPN. So it's not only IPsec as a protocol you can use for the branch office VPN connecting two FortiGates. Now you can use SSL VPN as well. So you can create a branch office VPN using the SSL protocol. And why is this important? Yeah, sometimes, for example, there are some modems from ISPs, which are not working well, which are dropping IPsec packets. They are dropping ESP packets, they are dropping UDP packets on port 500, or yeah, using those packets for themselves, terminating those packets for some reason. And in this case, it's really difficult to build up an IPsec tunnel. And in this case, you can switch to SSL VPN to get rid of those ESP or IPsec packets and use TCP 443, which, or another port you can choose, which is typically open, which is typically not dropped by any other device in between the two FortiGates. So the only thing which is important, let's say this FortiGate wants to build up as the SSL VPN client an SSL connection to a SSL server. So let's say this second firewall is my SSL VPN server, and this one is terminating, or is terminating, yeah, the SSL request from the FortiGate on the other side. So how to configure this? It's pretty easy. So first of all, I need on the server side a portal, a new portal like this one, SSL VPN BOVPN, and I'm using the tunnel mode here. I do not need the web mode. This is not necessary because I'm using the tunnel mode. I can enable split tunneling based on the policy destination or based on some specific networks I am configuring here. I will stay with this policy destination. That's okay so far. Yeah, that's all I have to configure. And now I go back to my SSL VPN settings, which is used by the normal mobile users, and now additionally by my branch office VPN. So the only thing I have to configure here is creating a new authentication portal mapping. So let's say I'm creating a new user. This is a local user on my server side, which is used by the remote FortiGate to build up the SSL VPN. So I've created a new local user. This is a local one. You will see this Labor2 SSL VPN, for example, here, this local user. Okay. Then I go back to the SSL VPN settings. So now I'm mapping this user to the new portal, which should be used by by the SSL branch office VPN. The only thing which is important here is that the server certificate, which is used by the SSL VPN server, that this one can be verified and checked by the SSL VPN client. And this means you are not allowed to use a self-signed certificate. Of course, this is not good best practice to use a self-signed certificate on your SSL for your SSL VPN. You should use a certificate with a proper signing certificate, which can be checked by the client. So how do we get such a certificate? Yeah, it's pretty easy. You can buy one. You will have to pay some bucks, but you can buy this from SwissSign, Quo Vadis, or whatever. Of course, you can create your own certificate authority, a local company certificate authority, or, and this is a new feature as well, and this is what I want to demonstrate here, you can create a new Let's Encrypt certificate. I'm pretty sure you know Let's Encrypt. Let's Encrypt is a certificate authority which allows you to create SSL certificates for free. The lifetime for this certificate is only 3 months, and once this is expired, you have to create a new one, or you have to renew your certificate. So the new feature of Fortinet, of FortiOS 7.0, is that you can create such a Let's Encrypt certificate automatically by your FortiGate. And this is something nice, because the FortiGate is doing all the stuff, creating the certificate, renewing it every 3 months, and you do not have to do anything for this. Just one time configuration, and then the rest is done by your firewall. And the good thing is, this is for free. So how is this working? I will show you on the other firewall, because here I've already configured such an certificate, but I want to demonstrate this live, how easy this is to connect to Let's Encrypt by your FortiGate. So what you have to do, you have to go to System Certificates. By default, you do not see the certificates here. If you want to see it, you have to enable the certificates here in the feature visibility. Normally, this is not enabled, but you can enable it. Then you will see this menu. You can go to the certificates. So right now, we only have the default Fortinet certificates here. So what I'm going to do now is going to import. I want to import a local certificate with the type automated. And this automated is the connection to Let's Encrypt, the interface to Let's Encrypt. So what I'm doing here, I give the certificate a local name. It's the ACME is the protocol which is used by Let's Encrypt to generate those certificate automatically. I call this certificate locally ACME Tech 2. So what I need to do, I need to configure a domain name. This is the local name of the firewall. So in my case, this is labor2.bol.ch. So this is one of the requirements you need for Let's Encrypt. Your FortiGate, where you want to create the certificate for, needs an interface in the direction of the internet. And this interface needs a public IP address. And you need a DNS name for this IP address. So if you do a lookup on labor2bol.ch, you will get the public IP address, which belongs to my firewall. Okay, so this is one requirement. You need an internet-facing interface on your FortiGate. This interface needs a public IP address, and you need a DNS name for this IP address. Okay, so additionally, I need some an email address for mail communication, and that's all. You do not need to do anything more. There's only one additional requirement: the public interface. So in my case, this is it's the WAN one, this one, 190 in the end. The requirement for this interface additionally is that port 80 and port 443 is not used by a virtual IP. So Let's Encrypt is communicating to your FortiGate on port 80 and port 443, and if you have a virtual IP, those packets will be forwarded to an internal server, and this is not allowed. So you need this IP. This is not allowed to used by any virtual IP based on port 443 or 80. So if this is not used, Let's Encrypt can talk with your FortiGate, and let's wait a minute and see what is happening. We are already ready. So the firewall has communicated to Let's Encrypt. Let's Encrypt has asked, are you still there? Is this your DNS name? Is everything okay with you? And now I have a perfectly good certificate for free, which is using a proper issuer, a proper certificate authority, and everything is fine. Now you have a public certificate on your FortiGate. Okay, It's phased out in 3 months, but doesn't matter because the firewall is automatically renewing this interface and this certificate. So it's not only this certificate which is free, you will all also have two other new certificates on your FortiGate. These are the CA certificate, the intermediate, and the CA certificate of this new server certificate. Okay. So this is what I have done on this other firewall before, is this certificate. And this is a good certificate which can be verified and checked by the other firewall when this firewall wants to build up an SSL VPN, a branch office SSL VPN. Okay. So when we have configured this certificate or any other public certificate, you do not have to use this Let's Encrypt interface, but it's a nice one. If you do not have any other public certificate or CA you can use this one. Okay, so now go ahead and create this SSL VPN with a branch office. So we go to VPN, and this is the new feature here. This is the SSL VPN client, and here you are configuring that your FortiGate wants to connect to the other FortiGate with a branch office VPN through SSL or the SSL VPN. So what I'm going to do here is create a new connection. This connection is getting the name. How do we want to call this? Doesn't matter. SSL VPN, branch office VPN client. I'm the client. Okay, so what is my outgoing interface? This is my public interface, the WAN interface, but for the SSL VPN, we need to create a virtual SSL interface. It's like the SSL root on the other side, a virtual interface for getting the SSL VPN, for connecting the SSL VPN. On our side, we need a new interface as well. And you have to create it. It's pretty easy. It's a new type, SSL VPN tunnel. It's like the SSL root, but you have to create it by yourself. It's not created automatically. You can give it a name, whatever, SSL client 2. And you have to define on which physical or on which public interface it's connected. So this is the interface where the SSL will start to connect to the other FortiGate. And in my case, it would be this public IP address here. So I've already created this interface, so I'm not going to save this one. I'm using this already created interface before. Okay. So next thing is configure the IP address of the server. This is the remote FortiGate where I want to connect my SSL VPN. And this has the IP address 194.199.86, and this is 151. This is the public IP. You can use a DNS name or FQDN name as well, whatever. Then you need the port. And in our case, it's the port 10443. This, of course, needs to match. Okay. So, and now I need a username for the SSL VPN connection. And this username is this Labor2 SSL VPN. So, we use this Labor2 dash SSL VPN. I need to know the password for this one. So, the other side needs to give me this password. It's like a pre-shared key. It's not really a pre-shared key. It's a password of this user. And this is, if I remember, oh, I think this was a typo. This one. Okay. So the only next thing you have to configure is the peer. What is the peer? The peer is the configuration how we are going to check the certificate of the remote FortiGate. So I will use this one and I will show you what is configured here. For some reason. Okay, so here this is a PKI user. This is a PKI user where you're configuring a CA certificate. And this needs to be the certificate, the CA certificate, which has signed the SSL VPN server certificate. So this is the reason why we need to use a proper certificate. We are not allowed to use a self-signed certificate because in this case with the self-signed server certificate, we cannot prove this certificate because it's self-signed. So here we just configure the CA certificate, which assigned the SSL VPN certificate, and then the FortiGate here can automatically verify if this is a good certificate or not. Okay. Additionally, you can use the subject, which is the CN, so we can just do it. We can use the name of the certificate or just a wildcard. This is working as well, but we know the name, so we can add this here as well. Okay, so with this, the FortiGate is able to prove or to verify, to check the certificate on the other side. Okay, once this is done, press OK. Right now, the tunnel is still down, but negotiation is already starting. Now we have to wait a little bit, and then this SSL VPN will come up automatically. Let's give it a moment. Here we are. So it's come up. It works, comes up automatically. Okay, so this is pretty nice, pretty easy. Of course, next thing we need is firewall policies, that firewall policies are configured from the local interface to this outgoing interface, and there you can decide which traffic is allowed and which traffic is not allowed, and so on. Of course, additionally, you can configure a client certificate as well. So you can configure that the client FortiGate needs to authenticate with a local certificate as well. And of course, here you can use your new Let's Encrypt certificate. So it's not only certificate-based authentication in one direction, you can use it in two directions on the client as well. Okay. In this case, if you want to do this, you have to configure here for this. Now we are using this edit in CLI. Huh? This is really nice. So we are in the settings, config authentication rule, edit one, set. And now you have to configure. If you want to use client certificate, you need to enable that client certificates are restrictive. So you want to have a certificate, not only the password on this side. So you have to configure this in, on both sides if you want to check the client certificate, of course. Okay, so yes, so it's pretty easy to establish a branch office VPN with SSL VPN. And just to double check, we are on the server side. If this SSL VPN is here, I'm going to the dashboard, to the network dashboard. Let's have a look here. This is our branch office SSL VPN. So if there has been a dial-up user, you would see it here as well. I just wanted to show another new thing in 7.0, because now you get some more information here. You get the information that this guy is connected less than 10 minutes. And if the connection would establish a little bit longer, then you will see that it has established for an hour or more than 8 hours, something like this. And if you go to the details, you will see it more. You will see the duration, you will see the type of connections, if it's a tunnel connection or a web mode connection, you will see the byte. So you, now you're going to see more information on the established SSL VPNs. You will get a yellow mark here. This said, okay, warning, two-factor authentication is not enabled. Normally with SSL VPN, yeah, we want to suggest to use not only a static password but also to second factor, and this is the warning for this. Of course, with the branch office VPN, yeah, maybe the remote FortiGate will have some problem to do some two-factor authentication, but you will get a warning here for this. And another nice thing you maybe know from the earlier version as well is this locate on VPN map. This is really nice as well. If you go on this locate on VPN map, you will see where your SSL VPN client is located. And yes, this could be Switzerland, huh? Let's check if this is, let's go to the details. Now, here we are. And yes, it's really precise. See Wettingen? We are located in Wettingen. It's not really here. It's not that building we are sitting at, but at least it's the right city or this the right village, I had to say. Wettingen is a small village. So we have really nice information about all the different, okay, in this case, it's only one VPN, but if you have several VPNs, you will have more information about this one. You will see where all the VPNs are located, the clients are located. Okay, so another nice feature, 7.0. You will get from the dashboard directly. That's a new thing. Okay, good. Yeah, so that is another nice feature, I thing, having a Let's Encrypt interface, having an SSL VPN. Let's go ahead. What else? Let's go to high availability. Pretty nice feature here. No, I will show you on this firewall because there's HA already configured. Okay, so there are three nice features introduced by 7.0 I want to introduce. First of all, in the last time, typically, we had a lot of support issues regarding the synchronization of a cluster. So we had a lot of support calls, hey, my cluster is out of sync, it's not synced anymore. So what is the problem? Where's the difference in the configurations? Yeah, and to analyze this, we always need to go to the CLI and do some strange commands to get some hash values, and then we know, okay, it must be here, must be there, that there's something not in sync. Or we had to create backups from both configurations and use another tool and use the to show the differences about both configurations. So this was really a little bit nasty. So news feature here, unfortunately I cannot show it because I'm so sorry, I wasn't able to find a second 60E to build up a cluster here, but maybe you can imagine if you have a second box here and the second box is not in sync, then the new feature is you can do a mouse over event on this not in sync flag and you will get automatically the information where the problem is, which configuration part is not in sync. It's all already shown on the web UI, and it's not only a strange hash value, it's a word like firewall address, something like this. So you will get the information why or where, at least where, the configuration is not in sync. So this is something which is really nice, I think. Okay. Next new feature from the HA is the time to do a failover. So let's say you have a cluster, everything is up and running, and now the master, there's no power anymore. So then the other firewall is not getting any heartbeats anymore. And after some time, normally after 1.2 seconds, a failover is done. So 1.2 seconds is the time the heartbeat needs to verify by default that the other device is not there anymore. Of course, this time can be configured. Let's go into the details. Normally, the heartbeat interval is 200 milliseconds. So the heartbeat interval by default is 100 milliseconds, but you have a factor you can configure. This is 2. So 2 times 100 milliseconds is 200 milliseconds. So by default, every 200 milliseconds a heartbeat is sent, and after 6 times where a heartbeat is not received, the other device is taking over. So this 100 milliseconds is something you can change. So you have a new feature here in the CLI where you can change the heartbeat interval from 100 milliseconds to 10 milliseconds. So with this, the heartbeat is sent much faster, much more often, of course, and then the failover can be done pretty earlier. You do not have to wait 6 times 200 milliseconds. Now you can wait 6 times 20 milliseconds, for example, and then you have a much faster failover. Of course, you need an environment where you can send such fast packets. So if you have a stretched cluster where the cluster members are divided into two different data centers and the normal communication takes more than 10 milliseconds, of course, in this case, you shouldn't use this feature. You should guarantee that a packet can be sent that fast. Of course. Okay, so this is the second new feature in 7.0, that you can have much faster heartbeat intervals and therefore a faster failover. And the last one I keep for the end is this new feature. We have a new feature that we can do a master failover if the memory of the master is getting over a specific threshold. And this is something I really love, because we have seen this very often. It's possible with, especially with the small 40 gates, that the memory is exhausted. You are getting in conserve mode with the master, and there's no failover. But with conserve mode, not everything is running well anymore. So you want to do a failover in this case, and now we can do this. Okay, so you can enable the memory-based failover, and you can configure some more specific configurations. So let's do a show full. Go to the end. Here we have all the important configurations. So what can you configure here? You can enable the memory-based failover. That means that if the memory of the master is getting over a specific threshold, which can be configured here. So the memory failover threshold can be something between 0% and 95%. So if it's getting over a specific threshold, like 95%, for a specific period, so it's not only if it's once a peak for 1 second and then it's getting down again, the memory. So, but if we have a period like 60, I think this is 60 seconds or minutes. Ooh, I'm sorry, I'm not pretty sure. Let's check this. Monitor period. It seems to be seconds, huh? I have to double check. I'm very sorry about this one. Let's make a get. Maybe we'll get the information then. Get. Oh, I will look in my notes. Huh? It's seconds. Sorry. In my notes, it's written down. It's seconds. Okay, I'm sorry for this one. Okay, so yeah, here we'll see it again in seconds. Right. Okay. So if the threshold is over, if the memory is over a specific threshold for a specific amount of time, and this is the sample rate, how often in this period we will check the memory. If this is the case, then we are doing a failover. So the strange thing here is the zero, huh? So of course, if the memory threshold is zero, we are always above the zero. Zero is something specific. Zero means if the memory or if the FortiGate is getting into conserve mode, whatever the threshold for conserve mode is. But if you have the zero here at the threshold, set memory failover threshold to zero, then as soon as the firewall is getting into conserve mode for a specific amount of time, then we are getting, then we are doing a failover. And this is something nice. I love this feature. Okay, cool. So that are the three top features from HA, in my opinion. Hopefully you think more or less the same. Let's go ahead. Let's go to the last topic. The last one. I love the automation stitches. Maybe you already know them. Maybe you're already using them. I want to show you some updates on this automation stitches. So what is new? Let's make an example. I'm going ahead and make an example. So I make a new automation stitch with the name conserve mode, conserve mode entered. Okay, something like this. This is enabled. So now I need to add a trigger, and of course this trigger, there's no existing trigger. I will create a new one. Conserve. Ah, I'm sorry. You will here see it right now. Conserve mode one, doesn't matter. Okay, so this is a name for a trigger object. This is an object, and the type is when the device is getting into conserve mode. So this is just an example for a trigger. You can create a lot of other triggers. For example, you can create a trigger on every single event log we know, or an incoming webhook, or you can have a schedule as a trigger. Every hour, do something specific, something like this. So in our case, I'm using this conserve mode situation. So if the device is getting into conserve mode, so what do you do then? So normally, what is my idea with this automation stitch? Normally, I want to be informed that my device is getting into a conserve mode. So I can troubleshoot why I can kill a process which is using too much memory or whatever. But if I'm not, let's do this first. So let's inform me that the device is in conserve mode. So how can we get informed? Emailing, FortiExplorer notification, we know this one, but what you might maybe do not know is that we now have a possibility to do alerts via Teams, Microsoft Teams. I'm not sure, but I think many of you guys during the situation we had in the due to Corona are started to use Teams. And now we can use the alerting in the Teams channel to receive those information from the FortiGate. So we have a new action, and I have already configured such an Teams notification here, and I'm going to use this just for demonstration. Okay, I will demonstrate it right now. So let's save this new automation stitch. So now I want to demonstrate this. It's really a little bit difficult to get into conserve mode right now, but there's a nice CLI command here. It's diagnose automation test. Ah, so now, sorry, I need the name. It's conserve mode entered. Let's see if I can copy this one. Yes, okay. Which really triggers this automation stitch. Okay, so now the action I had configured in this automation stitch, this alerting is done, and let's check. I have here my FortiAlerts. So yeah, it's exactly this one, huh? It's exactly kernel enters memory conserve mode at 4:45. Oh, I should finish. Huh? Ooh, okay. So let's go ahead. Sorry for this, a good time. So new action, getting notifications via Teams. So how is this configured? This is pretty easy. So I just want to show how we configure Teams notifications. The only thing you have to do here in Teams, I'm doing it with another channel here just to show it. Go to this menu, go to connectors, create a new incoming webhook. This one, configure a new one. I will say it's test. I say create it. It's German, sorry, but it means create it. And once I've created, I'm getting a URL. And this is the URL, you have to copy it. Now it's copied here. This is the URL you need for your alert. So let's create a new action like this team notification. And then you need to import this URL here. So just delete the HTTPS again. And this is how you get alerts into a specific channel. Pretty easy. Okay, that's all. Okay, so, but now I'm being alerted via Teams that my device is getting into conserve mode. And you see here, this is another new feature for the automation stitch. You can add several actions, not only one action, several one. And now, have a look. Now we are going to create a new action. It's a CLI action. Where is my CLI script? Okay, so if nobody is answering or nobody is responding to the Teams alert, I'm going to reboot my device. Because after rebooting it, it's most probably not in conserve mode anymore. So this is something really, really strong. Typically, I do not want to reboot my device, but if nobody is reacting on a conserve mode, I can say, okay. If there's no change in, let's say, in half an hour, then I'm rebooting the device to get out of the conserve mode automatically. Okay. Reboot it. Apply. Okay. So now I have the action. Give me an alert immediately via Teams. Wait half an hour. If the conserve mode, if the trigger is not ended, if it's nothing has changed, then do a reboot. And this is something nice. For example, to be honest, this example, I get this idea through a partner of us. He has a FortiGate at home. he's always testing the new stuff and with a small device, and he's doing a lot of firewall rules, profiles, and so on. So the small FortiGate is always exhausted in memory. And this is nice as long as he is at home, because when the device is getting into conserve mode, his family is arguing, hey, no internet anymore, what's happening here? So what he has done with this trigger is, okay, he is being informed. If he's not able to change it, the conserve mode, then the device is rebooting automatically to get out of conserve mode, and so that the family is happy again to have internet and so on and so on. Yeah, this is these are the new features from the automation stitches I wanted to show you. So this is might be really nice to combine several actions with a delay, and yes, getting alerts through Teams. I think many of you are using Teams, so this might be helpful as well. Yeah, okay, so unfortunately time is already over. There are some more feature. Of course, it wasn't my idea to show you 300 new feature, but at least some of them. And yeah, because time is over, I'm going to stop right now. I hope that there have been some nice feature you appreciate, that you find helpful for yourself or for your customers. And yeah, so I want to take the rest of the time to see if there are any questions. Victor, do you have any questions on the
Yes, we have a question from the audience. It was related to the SSL VPN. You see, the question is, what about having SSL VPN on the same public IP address? Is it possible in combination with the Let's Encrypt feature?
Yeah, so I think the problem is if the SSL VPN is using port 443 and Let's Encrypt is using port 443 as well. So the easy workaround is to use another port for the SSL VPN, for example, 10443. But to be honest, I have to admit, I didn't check this one. I know that VIPs are not allowed on port 443, but then because then the packets are going to be forwarded automatically. If it's SSL VPN, I have to admit that I'm not sure. Maybe the firewall can distinguish this. I have to double check this. I'm sorry, I cannot. I'm not 100% sure that this is not working. Maybe there's a chance, but I need to test it. So I do not say that it's working, but let's give it a try. We can try it right now, but then we cannot see if the renewal process in 3 months is working. So yeah, I need to try it with a new certificate. If we have a minute, I can do this. So let's give it a short try. Victor, do you have any other questions I can try to answer in between?
So there's from Kim another question. Do I have to set DNS and reverse DNS for Let's Encrypt to work?
Another good question, huh? I'm not sure if this reverse is really necessary. I'm sorry, I'm not sure about this, so I better not give you an answer when I'm not sure. I have to double check this. I'm not sure. I'm sorry. Okay, so I cannot say. So let's keep right. We will keep this down. I'll write this question down to test it later on. So in the meantime, No, I cannot test this this SSL VPN on the same port with a certificate right now, because I have to delete the certificate before. No, I'm sorry, Kim. I need to answer this later on. I'm very sorry, but I just want to be sure before I give you an answer, not to give you wrong information. This is something I do not like. So give me some time, please. Okay, sorry. Another question, maybe one that I can answer.
Yeah, currently we do not have any further open questions, so please feel free to raise any Q&A via the...
Or maybe you want to raise your hand, then I can give you the mic and you can ask on the phone. You do not ask by yourself. You do not have to type it down because we have some minutes left. No questions anymore. Oh, at least one that I can answer, please. Okay, give you some more minutes. Okay, so. No questions.
Maybe I would say everything is so clear, and maybe the people are also posted. There's a lot of information. I think. It's a good time then really to make your tests. And as you know, we are pretty sure if there are some questions, please reach out, ask your local teams or ask us, ask Fortinet. It's still something we have also to find our way, new features, but it's quite impressive. 300 features. I'm quite happy you have not presented all of them. Otherwise we have been really, really done on it. But, I personally really like this interface stuff that you can go and online edit stuff. You don't have to erase the previously defined things. This is quite impressive, but it can be quite complex. So always good idea to make maybe some backups before, but the system should be quite self-conserved. So it's not just going forward and crashing everything. That's a question from my side. What happens if I do this change? Is there a way back, an undo button?
Okay.
So my question is if I have this cool migration possibility to change the VLAN ID sensor, is there an undo?
Yeah. The good thing is if something is not working, the change is reverted automatically. And this is something I can show right here. So let's connect to this firewall with the CLI. So how do we show this? There is a nice CLI command. Maybe you know this. It's not eBay, it's INE. Debug CLI 7. 7 is the magic number for this command. This is a real-time debugger for the CLI, which means that everything which is done in the web UI can be seen in the CLI. So if I'm, for example, do this migration here, integrate interface into an SD-WAN, not sure if this is working, but let's say I want to do this here. Okay, and I do this, bam. Then you can see, okay, what is happening in the background through the web UI. So all the CLI commands that are done automatically through the background. And now I have a new error message I've never seen before. It must be deleted. Da, 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 da. Okay. Okay. Now I've got a failure. Okay. Delete and proceed or revert changes. So that is the point. You can go back and revert the changes. If you're running into an error, then it's reverted automatically. So in my opinion, nothing can happen. So if it's not successful, this migration, you're getting back to the initial configuration. But yeah, as it's not working 100% right now, so maybe give it a try in the first or second patch. Maybe this will be fixed later on to be 100% sure. Okay. So as we are already in the end, I just want to, in working with the CLI, I just want to give you another CLI command, which I like very much, especially for upgrading. There's one command, debug config error log read. Maybe you know this command, that's great. If not, maybe you can keep this one in mind if you're upgrading your firewall, no matter if you're upgrading to 7.0 or to any other release. If you have upgraded, your config will be upgraded to the new version as well. After the upgrade, after the device has been rebooted, use this command to check if all of your configuration was able to be upgraded to the new version automatically. Sorry, this is still the debug reset. So it's the debug config error log read. So if some of the configuration were not able to be updated to the new version, then the firewall will drop those configurations. And if some configuration has been dropped, you will see this with this command. Now it's empty, that's good. So the last upgrade was flawless. If you will have some output here, then you know this is the stuff which has not been upgraded. Config stuff that has not been upgraded. You have to use this command directly after the upgrade. If you're rebooting the device, then you will lose the output here. So use this command before you are upgrading the device a second time after the upgrade. So this is a nice one, I think, where you can really easily double check if everything was upgraded from your configuration, if everything works well. Okay, so this was the last hint I wanted to give you before we are finishing this session. Is there new questions in the meantime?
Has there been a question?
Yes, it's just quite a cool question. Is there a way to automate this revert changes after X minutes in case something goes wrong on a remote device and I lose connectivity?
Yes, but this is a workspace CLI command we already have for a long time. So I do not have this in mind, but I think there's a workspace command where you can say, oh, these are my changes, and then you have to apply them, or you can revert them. I'm not sure if this is what you are asking for. Maybe you can be a little bit more precise with the question, because reverting changes automatically if something goes wrong. How does the firewall decide if something went wrong or not? If you are losing connection, this is something the FortiManager can do. So if the FortiManager is updating your FortiGate with a new configuration and the FortiGate is not getting in touch after the config change anymore, then the FortiGate is automatically reverting to the previous configuration where the FortiManager was. Where the firewall was able to connect to the FortiManager. This is something we have with the FortiManager. But how can the FortiGate check if everything went well or not? So what's the reason for it? What's the proof for it? So I'm not sure about this one. So if there's no update, maybe get in touch with me personally. Just give me a call or write me an email, then we can discuss this point again. So maybe I'm not clear with my answer right now. Okay, cool. So now it's 5 o'clock. We are perfectly in time. Are there any other new questions? If not, then we should come to an end. Huh? Okay, hey, thank you for joining our session. I hope we could give you some nice features, something that is helpful for you, something that's interesting for you. I hope you had a good time. I had a good time. Thank you that you were joining us. I always have fun showing the new feature. I really have, yeah, it's great to see those great features with the new version. So let's see and get the update in some time. Okay, thank you for joining. Victor, last one from you.
So also from my side, thank you very much for your efforts, for your engagement out in the field. And if you have any questions, please reach out for the local team, reach out for Silvia and me. Stay tuned. We will send you in a regular update manner also our newsletters with the informations I mentioned. Also, this cool employee promo could be also a door opener to get to the latest, greatest hardware boxes and then go for 7.0. And we are looking forward to see how it's really getting new features with the .1, .2 and the .3 patches. But I think this is quite promising what you have seen already now. And thank you very much for your time. And hopefully see you in one of our next fast tracks or online sessions or whatever. And of course, we would love to see you in real life again. So maybe locally in the next sessions. Thank you very much and have a good afternoon. Bye from our side. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye bye. Have a nice time. Had a good time. Stay safe.